Hi everyone, let us study a new lesson, the ailing planet, the green movement and its role. Okay now, ailing planet, what is ailing? Ailment actually means a disease or a serious problem. Here the planet is ailing. Our planet is ailing. See, let us see what kind of ailment is that. It is by Nani Falkiwala. Have you heard of this name? You may not have. Okay, he was from 1920 to 2002. Yes. Once he was an authority on Indian constitution, even judges used to listen to his words. Such an expert he was, an eminent jurist and a great, intellectual he was, a man of learning, especially on law and constitutional matters. He appeared for many controversial cases also, including, the case of Indira Gandhi when Allahabad High Court declared her election null and void. It's a turning point in the history of India, because that is the reason why this emergency was declared in 1977. It goes to history. Okay, so he, once upon a time was a number one, jurist, means in a simple way, advocate of India, who was an expert in constitutional matters, an expert in constitutional matters. Let us see our lesson. Page number 43. One cannot remember any movement in the world history, in the history of the world, any movement which has gripped the imagination, yes, which has conquered the imagination of the entire human race, entire humanity, so completely and so rapidly means speedily, so fast, as green movement. Yes, green movement, gripped the imagination of entire humanity, which started nearly 25 years ago. It started nearly 25 years ago, not 25 years from now onwards. Let us see. First, it is given some notes. The following article was written by Nani Falkiwala and published in the Indian Express on 24th November 1994. 25 years before 1994. Okay, now? Yes, you have to remember that. You see, the article was published in the newspaper Indian Express. Okay, so 25 years ago, the green movement gripped the imagination of entire humanity. In the year 1972, the world's first nationwide green party, green movement, as you just say, party based on green politics and environmentalism, etc. and etc. You see, it is an organized political party actually. It began its function as an organized party based on environmentalism, then principles of green politics, etc. and etc. The first, the world's first nationwide green party. The green movement was inaugurated in New Zealand in the year 1972. Since then, the movement has not looked back. There was no reason for the movement to turn back. That means it has been on the marching forward. No turning back, no looking back. It is marching forward, says our Nani Falkiwala. In the year 1994, since the inception of this Green Party In New Zealand in 1972, the movement had no need to turn back or look back. It is always on the move. It is marching forward. We have shifted one hopes. We, human beings, we have shifted one hopes. One can expect that we have shifted irrevocably. That cannot be revoked. That cannot be changed. From the mechanistic view to a holistic, our viewpoint has been changed to holistic. What is holistic view? There is a humans and environment as a single system. The entire humanity as single unit. That is holistic ecology. So we see ecology as a, the entire, universe into one single unit. So, including all the creatures living on this planet. That's what. So, a holistic and ecological view of the world. So, we have shifted from a mechanistic view into a holistic view. Remember this phrase, it will be there at the end of our essay. So, we have shifted, we, the people living on the face of this planet. We have shifted our viewpoint towards a holistic and ecological view. Yes, it is a shift in human perceptions, means human understanding. See, our understanding has been changed now. We see the entire universe, humanity as one unit. Not only humans alone, we consider birds, animals, and even plants and everything together as one unit. So we cannot consider our survival separately. So we have to go together with all the creatures of this universe. They are also owners of this universe. All the living organism we have to take into consideration. Consider them as one among us and live together with them. And take this universe as one single unit. That is holistic viewpoint. Remember this, it will be there up to the end of our essay. Okay, now, so we have shifted from a mechanistic view into a holistic view. Yes, it's a shift in human perceptions, misunderstanding. You see, our viewpoint as revolutionary as it is, so revolutionary as that introduced by Copernicus. Do you remember this name, Copernicus? Nicholas Copernicus. He was the one who for the first time declared that the earth moves round the sun. Till then, what we believed was that the sun moved round the earth. Isn't it so? The reason was that until then, the teaching of religion was so strong in the mind of man. Because especially Catholic Church, Christianity and all taught that man is a supreme of all kinds of creations. He is the top of all creations. See, God created man in his own shape, etc. and etc. And man is a supreme of all creations. And this life on the earth is only a small phase. After that, we will go to Vihara. Our aim is to go reach heaven, etc. and etc. And suppose somebody says, or a scientific, geniuses, some or mathematicians, if they say that man's life is not important, man is one among the thousands of creation on this planet, and our planet itself is one among the many planets, and ours is a solar system, each star is like sun, and they are all having solar systems, and thousands of solar systems are there, and man is one among them, means the importance of man will be gone. Is it not so? So whoever told it for the first time, they were punished also, cruelly and severely punished. So it was a revolutionary declaration, finding out by Copernicus that the earth moved around the sun. Everything is moving. See, nothing is stagnant, is it not so? Everything is moving. All solar system, the earth, all the planets, everything is moving. Everything is changing, open to change. It is as revolutionary as the finding of Copernicus. This holistic view is as revolutionary as the finding of our Copernicus. Later on, only Galileo could prove it using his telescope. See, studying about the stars, there is proofs and evidence he was able to provide that really the earth moved round the sun, not the sun moving round the earth. It was so revolutionary, I mean, a finding out, the Copernicus finding out. Okay, now, our Copernicus, okay, introduced by Copernicus, who taught mankind in the 16th century that the earth and other planets revolved round the sun. So Copernicus declared that our earth and other planets, that means our solar system, is not so? All the planets are moving around the sun, solar system, you know the mechanism of it. Okay, now, for the first time in human history, there is a growing worldwide consciousness that the earth itself is a living organism. Just as our human body is a living organism, the earth itself can be considered to be a living organism. Yes, the earth has life, you know, not directly, but living organisms that are on the face of the earth. See, from amoeba to modern man, and the trees, then birds, all those things, they're all living organism. So if we consider the entire earth as single unit, we can find that the earth is a living organism. We remember Laburnum Top, when the bird came, then the tree was full of life. In the same way, the earth itself does not have any life in it, but all the organisms that are on the face of the earth, like human beings, animal, birds, and they're all living organisms. As a result of that, the earth itself is a living organism. Yes. Okay. An enormous being of which we are parts. It's an enormous organism of which we are parts of that, living organism. Yes. It has its own metabolic needs. You see, metabolic means, the process of, process in a living organism. The process in a living organism. Any living organism will have some process. Life. Okay, now that's what metabolism. Okay, its own metabolic needs. You see, so the earth will have its own metabolic needs. As every living organism will have some, processes and some needs are there. The earth also will have some metabolic needs and vital processes which needs to be respected and preserved. The needs of the earth should be respected as well as it should be preserved. So earth is a living organism. Our earth is a living organism. It has its metabolic needs and should be respected and preserved. So when you consider the earth as a living organism, of which we are parts of it. We are all parts of the living organism, our mother earth. So we are only exploiting it, you know, so we are maintaining it, we are protecting it. So take our mother earth as a living organism and respect its metabolic needs, and needs to be respected and preserved. We have to preserve the metabolic needs of a living organism as our mother earth is. Let's move on. Yes, vital signs reveal the vital signs of the earth. The present signs, see how it is, the present condition of earth reveal that a patient in declining health. So the earth and its condition can be compared to a patient in declining health. You see, suppose a patient had been in the hospital, slowly his health is going down, we can understand what is going to be the final result. For example, first outpatient, then inpatient, then ICU, then ventilator. Okay, so the earth condition is moving from bad to worse, worsening every second or every minute. Is it not so? So earth condition can be compared to a patient whose health is declining. We have begun to realize our ethical obligations. So humanity as a whole, we have begun to realize and to understand our ethical obligations. Means our responsibility. Yes, we have some responsibilities.
See, to be good stewards of the planet. Steward here is managers. We are the managers of this planet. We have to protect, preserve our planet. Isn't it so? So we are the stewards, the managers of this planet. And we have to preserve and protect this planet. And responsible trustees. Who is a trustee? One who is in charge of. It's not his, but he is in charge of that. So we are the trustees of this planet. Of the legacy. See? Legacy means what we get from our predecessors, which we have to hand over to the coming generation, successors. Isn't it so? So the legacy to future generations. So we have the obligation or duty to hand over our legacy, what we have got from our predecessors, to hand over to the successors. It's our duty to hand over what we are given by our predecessors. Isn't it so? Yes, to the coming generation with, same as it was given to us. You see, with no degradation or going down. Okay, now, a legacy to future generations. Being the stewards, which managers, and the trustees, those who are in charge of. So, we have the obligation, we have the duty to hand over this planet to future generation without any damage. So we should not damage our planet by over-exploiting it or destroying it. You see, we have the duty, being the stewards and trustees of the planet. So we have the duty to hand over our planet to coming generation without any damage. Let us move on. The concept of sustainable development. Yes, the underlying word, sustainable development. Development that is sustains, remains, say without damage. Sustainable development. When I read this line, what came to my mind was a lesson in the 10th class state syllabus. What's that? Environment. Vangari Mathai, do you remember? Yes. She was telling about the three legs of African stool. Sustainable management of resources. Natural resources. That's what. Okay. Then only we three legs are there that we can put a stool on that. That is a development. If only sustainable distribution of natural resources possible, that development is possible. Here is a sustainable development. Development that is a sustainable. See, going on without any damage. Was popularized in 1987 by the World Commission on Environment and Development. So, it was popularized. So, sustainable development. So, development should be sustainable, should be sustained. So, continuing for long, long, long years, not temporary. Isn't it so? Sustainable development. Yes, which is remaining forever. Was popularized. So development should be sustainable. That idea was popularized in 1987 by the World Commission on Environment and Development. In his report, it defined the idea as development that meets the needs of the present. So development that meets the needs of the present, present day generation, our needs. You see, without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their needs. So our needs must be, needs should be met without compromising the needs of the future generations. So when we are meeting our needs, the needs of present generation, we should not compromise on. That means we should not overexploit our planet and make an empty planet with no resource remaining for the future generations without compromising the needs of future or coming generations. Yes, that is, without stripping, means removing the natural world of resources. Yes, without cutting out or removing the natural world of resources for future generations that they need. So without removing the resources for a future generation, they should be able to get their due. So what we are given by your previous generation our ancestors, we should be able to hand over without damage to the coming generations. So they should be able to meet their needs. So we should not compromise on, I mean, the needs of future generations. Let us move on. In the Sioux at Lusaka, Zambia, he tells an example here. In a zoo at Lusaka, Zambia, there's a cage where the notice reads, if you go to the zoo, you can find a notice. I mean, in a cage, the world's most dangerous animal. The notice is that the world's most dangerous animal. Inside the cage, there is no animal but a mirror where you see yourself. Yes, what does it mean? Man is the most dangerous animal. So he is, conquering, dominating over all the creatures of this universe. Birds, animals, plants. In such a way, he is the most dangerous animal. After the arrival of man, the entire ecosystem changed because he is dominating over. Suppose a large number of animals, are killed or destroyed, the entire ecosystem will change. Large number of trees are removed by deforestation. You see, the ecosystem will change. So he is dominating over all other living organisms, birds, animals, including trees. So in such a way, man is the most dangerous animal in this universe. Yes, thanks to the efforts of a number of agencies. You see, in different countries, many agencies are there. A new awareness has now dawned upon, has arisen, is not so? There is a new awareness dawned upon the most dangerous animal in the world. A new awareness has come, in the mind of the dangerous animal, that is man. So man has now got a new, a vision or new awareness. He has realized the wisdom of her. So now he has realized, understood the wisdom of her. Shifting from a system based on domination to one based on partnership. So now he has realized that he must accommodate or change from a system of domination to a system of a partnership, which means so he should not dominate over other living organism, but he should live in partnership with the other living organisms. All living organisms he must live in partnership with, which means he must accept that they are also owners of this valuable, precious earth of ours. So his awareness is that he has changed his attitude from domination. Till now he has been dominating over all the living organisms, including trees, animals, birds, all kinds of creatures, fishes and plants also. So the domination is gone now. Now he realizes that he must live in partnership with all other living organisms. Let us continue. Scientists have cataloged about 1.4 million living species. There are 1.4 million living species with which mankind shares the earth. So we are sharing the earth. So we are in partnership, you see, with the 1.4 million creatures are there, which are cataloged, listed creatures are 1.4 million. So we have realized that there are more than 1.4 million creatures are there, which are cataloged. Yes, estimates vary widely as regards still uncatalogued living species. How many are remaining uncatalogued? Opinion differs. Is not so? Biologists reckon that about 3 to 100 million other living species still languish unnamed. 3 to 100 million living organisms or creatures or species are there which are uncatalogued. See, opinion differs on how much or how many are there, but it is certain, it is sure that from 3 to 100 million species are there, they remain uncatalogued. So listed species are 1.4 million. So uncatalogued, 300 to 200 million. Is it not so? Still languishes remain unnamed. See, in ignominious, which means unknown. So, ignominious darkness. They remain in darkness. See, names not known. Uncatalogued creatures are, see, 300 to 200. So, we have to live in partnership with all those living organisms, all those species. So, our attitude has been changed. In what way? Till now, attitude was that of domination. Dominate over all the, species. Now it has become something of partnership. See, there are 1.4 million species which are cataloged. There are 300 to 200 million species are there which remain uncataloged, and they languish, means they remain unnamed in ignominious darkness. They remain in a unknown darkness. Yes, let us move on. One of the early international commissions, International Commission, which dealt inter alia. Inter alia is a Latin word. In 10th class, you studied some words which are taken directly from Latin, etc., from other languages. We take it as it is. Alma mater, ipso facto. Do you remember them? Yes, many words are there, you know. So, suo motu. So, especially those words are used for, court proceedings. So, the words are taken as it is. There is no change for that, no translation. So, take the word as it is and we use it as part of our language. So, the same way, inter alia from Latin, which means among other things. The meaning of inter alia is among other things. So, one of the early international commissions which dealt, among other things, with the question of ecology and environment was the Brandt Commission. Yes, Brandt Commission is an independent commission which studied on environment, green politics, etc. See, and Willy Brandt was the chairman of that. An independent commission studied about this environment, ecosystem, etc. etc. Okay, so Brandt Commission, which had distinguished Indian, in that commission there was a distinguished, means a famous Indian. There is an Indian in that commission as one of his members. In Brandt Commission, a distinguished, a famous Indian was there as a member of it, and he was Mr. L.K. Cha, isn't it so? And his name was L.K. Cha. The first Brandt report raised the question, and the commission raised a very valuable question. Are we to leave our successors? Are we going to leave, means give our successors a scorched planet? Means burned out, means exhausted, with no resource remaining. A scorched planet, as a of advancing deserts. The area of deserts increasing, not the forest. See, forests are cut and removed, and desert is increasing. See, advancing deserts, impoverished landscapes. See, impoverished made into poor. See, reduced to poverty. Impoverished, you see, reduced to poverty. Impoverished landscapes. So landscapes are made poor, means all the resources being exploited, and ailing environment, means degraded. See, environment is ailing. Ailment for the entire environment. Why? Because pollution is there, deforestation is there. Is it not so? Even water is not so. In the lesson environment, for the first paragraph, it will be so. Forested mountains is not so. Are the source of our water. So, water resource will change. Rainfall pattern will change. Deforestation is the main reason for that. We saw. You studied in 10th class. Just remember all those things. Yes, are we going to leave? Is it, or give? Or hand over? To coming generation, a scorched planet. You know, so then impoverished landscapes. വെരി പൂവർ വിത്ത് നോ റിസോഴ്സസ് റിമൈനിങ് ലാൻഡ്സ്കേപ്പ് ആൻഡ് എയിലിംഗ് environment, even the environment is ailing. Yes, Mr. Lester R. Brown, in his thoughtful book, The Global Economic Prospect, Mr. Lester R. Brown, in his book, the name of the book, The Global Economic Prospect, points out that the Earth's principal biological systems are four. See, the Earth's principal biological systems are four. Let us see, what are they? Number one, fisheries. Number two, forests. Number three, grasslands. Number four, croplands. Yes, these are our main resources. See, our main resources are these. What are they? Fisheries, forests, grasslands and croplands. Yes, they are the Earth's principal biological systems. They are the real resources, isn't it? So, forest, then fisheries, water, sea, rivers, canals, everything. Fisheries, then grassland, then croplands. These four are our main source of resources. And they form the foundation of a global economic system. The foundation of global economic system is this, or these four are the base or foundation of global economic system. What are they? Just remember them. What are they? Fisheries, forest, then grassland and croplands. In addition to supplying our food, these four systems provide virtually all the raw materials for industry. They provide all the raw materials for a industry except minerals and petroleum derived synthetics. Yes, many synthetic products are made out of petroleum products, isn't it so? Yes, we import, isn't it so, petroleum products that is refined here, okay, in our refineries. So from that we make many artificial synthetic products. Suppose natural rubber is there, but there is a synthetic rubber, isn't it so? So petrol prices, when it goes down, we can produce it at a cheap rate, okay, na? So except petroleum derived synthetics and minerals. So these are the raw materials for our industry and industrial growth. Okay, in large areas of the world, human claims on these systems. So human claims, so humans are using, see, exploiting, that's what claim is here. So exploiting these, systems are reaching an unsustainable level. Yes, it has reached an unsustainable level. See, let us think just for one moment. What is our main source of energy even in 21st century for the people of India? Main source of energy, can you say? Yes, it is a petroleum products. Either petrol, diesel for vehicles to run. In our kitchen, what do we use? LPG. Yes, petroleum product. See, you should know that, we should know that all these petroleum products actually, from fossils it is collected. Isn't it so? Fossil energy, which is which will be finished one day, not near future, but in future, you see, it will be over. It is not like your solar energy or wind energy, you see, which will never be over. So many developed nations' dependence on this kind of fossil energy, etc., is only maybe less than 30%, but for us it is 85% or something. Is it not so? Our total, energy needs are met, not total, around 80% or above 80% of our energy needs met by this kind of petroleum products. Is it not so? Even 21st century. So our development is very, very, very slow. Actually, we should, turn our attention towards solar energy, wind energy, nuclear energy, all these things are there in India, but only a small amount. So we depend more on this kind of a hostable source of energy. Okay. So we are claiming more on these resources, that four resources of our Mother Earth. Okay, human claims on these systems are reaching unsustainable level. That's what? Unsustainable. Yes, a point where their productivity is being impaired. So, when these used over exploited, their productivity become impaired, means less effective. As a result of that, the productivity becomes less effective. When this happens, fisheries collapse. When over-exploitation happens, fisheries collapse, forest disappear, deforestation, forest disappear, grasslands are converted into barren wastelands, and croplands deteriorate, means worsen. Okay, now grassland, cropland, all those things are over-exploited. In protein-conscious and protein-hungry world, in a world where it is which is protein conscious and protein hungry, food is a main, is not so need. Overfishing is common every day. Fishing is overfishing, too much exploitation. Okay, it is happening every day. In poor countries, local forests are being decimated, means removed completely, cut and removed completely, in order to procure firewood for cooking. In many countries, many poor countries, the source of energy is firewood. They prepare their food using firewood even now in 21st century. In some places, firewood has become so expensive that, see, firewood has become so expensive that what goes under the pot now costs more than what goes inside it. Did you get the meaning of that? What goes under the pot, that is firewood, is more costly than what goes inside it. The food items are less costly than firewood used for a source of energy. So firewood is so costly that what goes under the pot for boiling, is not so, for preparing food. So our firewood will cost more than the food items that we prepare for our basic need of food or eating. So what goes under the pot for preparing food is more costly than what goes inside the pot. So firewood has become so costly in some areas. Since the tropical forest is, in the words of Dr. Myers, the powerhouse of evolution. Yes, tropical areas, the powerhouse of evolution. Several species of life face extinction. In tropical areas, several species of life is facing what? Extinction. As a result of destruction, many species are wiped out from the face of the earth. So we are exploiting, over-exploiting all the resources of our mother earth, of our planet. So what are the main resources? What are they? Once again, remember, forest, fisheries, grassland and croplands. We are exploiting it. Yes, over-exploitation. So, we may not have so much resource remaining to be handed over to the next generation. That's what we are discussing here. See, okay. So, we cannot complete the entire lesson 1 video. We will complete in second video. Okay, once again, go through the lesson what we have seen. If there's any doubt regarding, let me know it. I will clarify. Thank you for watching.